Welcome, everybody. This is Lisa Gosto here with a special event that we want to surprise everybody. First of all, I want to introduce, obviously you guys know this individual from Mortal Kombat. He's my great friend, Daniel Piscina.
Hey, Luis.
Danny, what's up, man? What's
up, Sucio? From the United States.
We're only 4.5 hours away, so not that far. How are you, Dan?
Good. You know, it's we're in the U.S. We're getting rid of the restrictions for COVID, so it should be back to shenanigans as usual.
We're going to be partying soon, definitely. I also, and this is where I wanted to, we have a special guest that we wanted to bring to the party, the Mortal Kombat party. You might, as you all know, I'm pretty sure everybody that's watched this and that knows about Mortal Kombat knows about Big Trouble in Little China. And if you know about Big Trouble in Little China, you know about the Three Storms. And we have Lightning with us today. We have Mr. James Pax. Welcome.
Hello, everybody. Hi.
Hey, James.
It's eating
off. How are you?
I'm very well. Just so you know, I'm in China, in the beautiful island of Sanya, which is like the America, Hawaii island.
Oh.
So I'm just taking a little break here, a little vacation.
Well, thank you for taking the time for this this interview. I'm, you know, obviously for me it's an honor to have you. For Dan as well.
Oh, yeah.
And I did a little bit of research. I know that you obviously actor, but also director, producer, author. You even were a model at one time. Is that accurate?
Yes.
There you go. So I, you know, basically we wanted to, my first question, I kind of wanted to have you guys, you know, just tell us a little bit about how you guys know each other.
It's a long time ago, over 20 years ago we met, and it's been long lost friend because, you know, I traveled to Asia quite a bit and currently I'm living in China. So we've been long lost friend for 20 years and we just found each other about 2 months ago, you know, on the Instagram through a friend's, we got connected again. So it's like an old friend that I haven't seen for 20 years. So I'm so glad to see Daniel still healthy, doing his kung fu, just like myself. You know, we were just talking in the last 2 months. I said, we are the oldies. I mean, you can tell we both are over 50 years old, but we are the oldies and we're still looking young. I feel like 30. I don't know about you, Daniel, but I feel like 30 every day. And
guys,
I said, we are the oldies, but we are the goodies.
Yeah, you guys look younger than I do. What are you?
Yeah, and it's again with my friendship with James is not only a friendship, but it really is for me an inspiration to have James as like not only a friend, but for really inspiring me to continue with the path of, you know, no offense, Chinese martial arts into cinema, you know, into media, into the video games, into everything I've really done. James' work, not only in Big Trouble, but, you know, his work in general has really inspired, like, me as a Chinese martial artist and an actor.
Speaking of martial arts, James, can you tell us a little bit about or tell me, I know Dan probably knows already, but can you tell me a little bit about your martial arts background?
Well, how I started was, I think just like many of the Bruce Lee, Bruce fans, we don't even need to mention his last name. I've been a big fan of his since I was like a teenager, you know. And back then I was living in Hong Kong with my parents. And almost every day, almost every week, you can see Bruce on the TV being interviewed and doing all that amazing thing. And his movie is already out. And he was a hero to me. I'm sure he's the same to many people. But as you know, back in the 80s, there wasn't any Chinese heroes at all. I mean, Jackie Chan, you don't even know where he is. He was just a stuntman back then. But Bruce Lee kind of brought Chinese culture into the world, totally. I mean, Chinese were the first immigrants, one of the first immigrants to America to help build the railroad, which I'm sure many people know. And I also did a play on that. And they became restaurant owners and did laundry shops and all of that. They brought that side of the American Chinese culture to America. But where's Bruce? He opens up the entire Chinese culture and the Chinese race, I would say, to the entire world and to get the respect from everybody else. Because, you know, 40 years ago in the 80s, Hong Kong, oh, it's a third world country. You know, that's how they call it. But it became known because Bruce came from Hong Kong. And that's what inspired me. But since I was a kid, I was already into different martial art, you know. But he is the man that really started everything. And almost every one of his moves, I can do it perfectly. I would say everything he does, 90% I can copy it and just as fast, including the nunchucks and all of that, which I know Daniel also do a very good version of it. Mm. That's how I became a big fan of his till today. I still do his moves, you know, that's how I got started. But if you talk about my skills, anything from Taekwondo to Karate, Aikido, Wing Chun, Chinese Wushu, which I know Daniel's an expert on that, mm-hmm. I do it all, basically. And on top of that, you know, since I was 18, another person that inspired me in terms of my career in art was Nureyev. You probably don't know who he is, but let me give a little introduction. Nureyev is like Baryshnikov. They were the two Russian male ballet dancers back in the 80s, was the most famous in the world, just like Valentino, you know, right. Rudolph Valentino. But they were the closest one. And one time I went to a Metropolitan, I can't remember which theater, but I saw Nureyev. I only heard about him, only seen him on TV, never saw him live. But when I went on the theater and watched him dance, I said, that is Bruce in ballet shoes. Hmm. So from then on at 17, from being just a kung fu man, I learned to do ballet, wearing these, you know, tights. People are gonna think, oh, you are a sissy. I said, I'm not a sissy, but I'm combining kung fu with my ballet together. And that's why I claim myself to be a ballet dancer. And then from then on, went to become a jazz dancer, just like all that jazz. So through my career, combining these two arts really extended my acting career. That's basically how I relate myself to kung fu, combining with ballet. And also I did many of these MTVs, much early on. I was the only male Asian dancer that was among all these MTVs back in the early, mid 80s, I would say. That's how I started.
Wow, that's very interesting. I definitely, you know, I feel sorry for the person that tried to make fun of you for, because they didn't know what was really there. So so you talk about that transition into acting. Obviously, we know about your amazing role in Big Trouble in Little China. Just to tell you a little bit of a story, when I was a kid, you know, a movie came out in 86, I was born in 82. When I was a kid, I went to a video store with my mom, and my mom would always let me choose like one movie. I always picked the movie that had a truck in the cover or a semi, you know, because I was a kid, I love trucks. And my pick was Big Trouble in Little China. And I did not know what I was getting into, but I loved it. But one of the coolest scenes, and I know that I'm getting ahead of myself here, but one of the coolest scenes that I always stick to my mind is that when the three storms come out, but your entrance, in my opinion, was the coolest one, because you are coming down
on the, from the ceiling.
Yeah, and it's like the lightning, like you're holding into the lightning exactly. and coming down. And I always thought as a kid that that was the coolest thing in the world. But how did you get involved? How did you get how did you get into this audition? How did you get involved with the movie?
Right. It was kind of a long preparation for it because I had an agent in New York back then who was a very big agent. He handled many Kevin Kline and all these stage actors. And but I won't go into it, but he said, John Carpenter is coming to town to New York. They want to see all that, the action guys. And I know you can do your kung fu. You need to prepare for this role. This is going to be a huge role in the next John Carpenter's movie, and it's called Big Trouble in Something. I said, what? Little China? I said, my God. I mean, finally, Hollywood came to realize that Chinese subject matter means money. I said, yes, I'm going to prepare myself. So back then, I was also training with the Chinese wushu guy that came from Beijing, you know, the original wushu guy, Chinese guy who doesn't even speak much English. He was having his own little studio, so I usually train with him. And then I say, we gotta prepare ourselves for this audition. You know, I don't know what kind of part they want me to do, but we need to do something related to action. So we choreograph for like a 3 weeks, like twice a week, we were practicing with all kinds of broadsword and with the spears and everything. So we finally came up with a 10-minute nonstop action from weapons into hand fight, hand combat, and we went in there and we blew them apart. And then and John was like, incredible. And he was elated. He said, you are the best action guy I've seen so far in New York.
So John was there present when you guys were doing this action scene?
Yes.
Wow.
And he was really impressed, and that's how I got the role. And
how did he present the, like, how did that conversation about the characters come through? Like, did he mention, like, hey, this is what I have? How did that?
He didn't have me, I did some reading, you know, actually I did the reading for the leading role, Dennis Dunbar. I can't remember his name, you know.
Wong Chi.
Wong Chi, yes.
Yeah.
He was the leading role, you know, because I'm a very ambitious guy. I never want to take any small roles. Mm. Whatever I do, I say I'm going to be the best. Otherwise, I don't even want to do it. So I read for that role. He didn't say anything. He said, well, the action was incredible. That's all I remember. Then 2 weeks later, my agent said, hey, you got a role. You got a role. I said, oh, thank you. But you know what? On the same week that I got the offer from John was General Hospital, mm. big thing in New York, you know. Mm-hmm. And General Hospital was looking for an Asian actor to be the series regular. Again, it is a, what do you call it? You know, the first time ever that General Hospital want to hire an Asian guy to be a series regular. Mm. And I remember before that, I was already teaching one of the guys from General Hospital how to do Kung Fu. You know, he was very nice. He paid me like $100 per hour just teaching Kung Fu. So I already know about General Hospital, and I asked him, how much money do you make a year? He said, close to $1 million. I said, okay, so I want to be on General Hospital. But when my agent said, you know, you got Big Trouble in Little China, I said, well, you know, we just got the offer also on General Hospital. So which one do you think I should take? He said, well, General Hospital is going to keep you for 2 years. But if you go on this thing with John, you're going to be moving over to Hollywood, and there might be more opportunity on the bigger screen for you. So I advise you to take this job. Mm. Fine. So I got shipped over to LA immediately. You know, I put on this incredible costume. And just the costume fitting took 3 times, you know.
Wow.
But the costume was custom made, and it was just amazing. You know, all those armor plates.
The metal plate.
Really, really beautifully done. I don't even know how they did it, but it was designed such incredible look to it. And then you mentioned about the lightning thing. When we were shooting it, you know, we were on wire. And then we were dropped down, like me was dropped down from the ceiling. Every other guy was just doing his thing, and I was dropped down from the ceiling. And John said, you have to hold your lightning like you're holding it, but that's going to be added after. I said, okay. But remember, back in the 80s, that was made in 80, I think, there was no CGI. So only after the movie came out, I see myself. I said, oh my God, that's what they did. Because when they were shooting it, it started just looking like I'm being, you know, wired up, you know, and you can see the wire, and they had to use the pen to take all that wire out and then add in the lightning, and it looks so real. That's why you were impressed with the lightning, the arrival of lightning. And I was impressed myself as an actor, basically. So I really think all that beautiful art should be done today instead of all that CGI. You know what's so amazing about Big Trouble? Although it didn't make it do as well back 20, 40 years ago, it only made like 10 or 15 million, you know, in the US box office.
10 million, yep.
And then around the world, I think it did a lot better. And then 20 years later, they realized it was a classic.
Cult classic, you know, yeah.
Cult classic. I think it is because of the characters and also because the sets. Look at the sets. Mm-hmm. There was nothing CGI, everything. I remember we were on 8 studio sets. So in every big studio, it's almost like half of the base of a football field. You have a set, you have a set, you have a set. And we are running from set to set, real sets. Everything is real, including those Buddhas was real, you know. It's so amazing that Hollywood make a movie on Chinese subject matter and make every set real and it's not painted. And that's why I have so much respect for John Carpenter's production, especially on Big Trouble.
And what's interesting about it, it's that at the time, it's a Hollywood production that it's heavily Asian casted. Like it has like majority of the cast is I think there were probably 5 or 6 only American roles in the movie. And one perspective that I had from the movie when I rewatch it is the fact that that the real star of the movie, like the real, is not even Jack Burton. Jack Burton, you know, Kurt Russell's character, because Kurt Russell's character is a little clumsy and it's kind of like, hey, we gonna get this done, but he gets knocked in the head and everybody just starts fighting and, you know, and everybody's having, you know, you mentioned Dennis Dunn, like Dennis Dunn that looked more like he was the hero besides Jack Burton. Exactly. So it was... It's incredible to see that example of obviously martial arts and Asian culture just presented in the big screen. Definitely, I'm gonna bring Dan here for a moment regarding a question about lightning, because obviously we know that lightning was the inspiration for the character Raiden in Mortal Kombat. Correct me if I'm wrong, Dan, but did you talk to James when the character was thought out, like, hey James, guess what, we're doing a character like Lightning, it's called Raiden? Or how did that happen, how did the creation of Raiden occur?
Yeah, as far as like Raiden as a character, John wanted Raiden to be the Japanese god of thunder, but that was how he described the character, but not necessarily what we wanted the character to be, because when we were pitching the game to Midway, we had a lot of references to Big Trouble in Little China. You know, even for my main character, Johnny Cage, you know, his projectile, when he throws the alchemy, I took that out of Big Trouble in Little China, you know, and the whole game has so much homage to that game to that movie, because it really inspired like a whole genre of martial arts. Because before, you would see guys doing karate and things like that. Oh, I'm doing karate and doing like that. But this movie was really focused heavily on Chinese martial arts, which everyone who did Mortal Kombat was heavily into Chinese martial arts. So two, it wasn't like the way it happened, and it was such a small game. It wasn't really like, hey, I'm going to reach out to James and kind of tell him what we're doing, because we really didn't know what it would turn out with. Mm. You know? But Tobias had this vision of the Japanese God of Thunder, but my brother Carlos is such a big fan of James. He was like, if you really watch like the footage of what's happening, he mimics a lot of what James put into Big Trouble in Little China. The way the lightning shoots in between his fingers, the way he like holds his hand up and then the lightning comes down and just like that. So though the company will say like, oh no, we had this idea. But if you ask the person who really created the character, he would be like, oh yeah, I was acting like James Paxton, Big Trouble in Little China.
And even speaking of Carlos, because, you know, Carlos, I say hi to him because I love that Susio, but even the motion, I remember that Raiden would make, like, it's in the side cabinet in Mortal Kombat 2. Like, he's raising his hand towards the sky and the lightning is coming off just like James did in the movie, coming down the lightning. So there's definitely that noticeable inspiration from the movie. James, were you ever asked in the street about Mortal Kombat? Like, hey, there's this character that's kind of like yours in this video game.
Yes, I have been reminded of that many times by my fans and by my friends and all of that. Although I personally don't play much of the video game, but I do some research on it. I really think there are a few characters alike, definitely Johnny Cage, which I know Daniel is the one that started the character. You know, because the way they designed it, he was a movie star, an action movie star to begin with. So I can relate to that. And the other one was definitely Raiden, you know, because it was taken from my character. I'm honored. I'm just an actor, you know, I'm honored that my character is being transformed into Mortal Kombat, which came after us and it did very well, you know, made all that movies and besides so hundreds of millions of people playing on that game. So I personally, I'm very honored to be part of it and mentioned about Mortal Kombat. I love the role of Liu Kang because he's from Shaolin Temple. I will tell you a little more about my new project later. Danny already knows, but I will share with everybody on the second half of the interview. And then, of course, the lady, what was it? Sonya Blade.
Yes.
You see, these are the few characters I personally like very much. And so basically, that's how I'm related to Mortal Kombat. I really look into the characterization, how they do it. And it was very much in details. You know, they tell you which these characters are and all of that. But one thing I got to say about Mortal Kombat, the original form, the original game, it was done with the motion capture. I think that's how we call it. It was so original. I think even back then, even I watched it, I said, it looks so real because every move is done by a real person. Instead of these days, I think they, you know, if you look at other games, you're just having see this guy running around and then he just goes, dum, 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 and everybody's dead. You don't see any action. It's all computer action. But in the original Mortal Kombat, because every move is done by a real person, so you can see how they move and how they throw the weapons and all that. And I thought that was original. And if I'm actually exploring about my own Shaolin Warrior 7, that's the name of my movie, on what kind of video game am I gonna put out? And if I'm gonna put out my video game, I wanna go back to that original so that you can see every move that's coming. Instead of the new ones that you just go dun 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 dun, you know, or the one you know in the wars, you see the person and then he just takes a Uzis and just shoot dun, 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 and everyone right. is dead.
Right.
I think that's more for quick game, but for the real art, I think that the original Mortal Kombat game was ingenious.
It was
created ingeniously.
It was definitely ahead of its time. How did you, obviously we know Mortal Kombat has the fatalities. Did you ever see Dan's characters, let's say Johnny Cage, did you ever see Dan's character have a fatality, like get decapitated or something. What was your reaction when you first saw that, your friend being like electrocuted or?
Everything on that game was just simple fun. I mean, it was very bloody. You know, you see the head got chomped off and the blood coming up. But it is kind of a gaudy, funny. That's what makes it so interesting to me. It doesn't look like violence. It looks like a comic book character or, a cartoon character. So I love it. I love the game of it, although I don't really play it. But I love all the elements that make Mortal Kombat special. It also reminds me of later on, what's his name? The American famous director, one of my favorite. He did the action movie with a Chinese American actress and Uma Thurman. What is that movie?
Is it Kill Bill?
Kill Bill, yes. What's his name? Quentin Tarantino.
Quentin Tarantino, yes.
I don't know if Mortal Kombat came before Kill Bill.
It did.
But
it was before Kill Bill, yeah.
It is, I can tell you, Quentin definitely took up some of that Mortal Kombat, all that gaudy action.
Okay.
You know why? Because I love Kill Bill. And he had one scene that I think, I can't remember how it's done, but anyway, he hits somebody's head and the head comes off. And then in the backdrop, you just see the blood going, coming out. Right. That looked just like Mortal Kombat. And I'm a director. I can tell you he's definitely inspired by Mortal Kombat.
Wow, Quentin Tarantino, right? That's gotta be amazing. I also wanted to ask you about your time on set in Big Trouble in Little China. Obviously, you work with Kurt Russell, James Hong. There's so many great actors in that movie at the time. But obviously, your partners, your team, Peter Kwong as Rain and Carter Wong as Thunder. How did you guys know each other before the movie? Did you guys still talk? What was that interaction like?
Well, like I said, I'm a New Yorker. So it was my first movie in Hollywood. And, I just got off the plane. The next thing you know, I was brought over to the set and met everybody. So it was my first time meeting all the Hollywood wonderful Asian community and working with John and the leading actors and all that. So it was an experience for me to kind of, I should say, melt into that community, Asian community. And it was good to know that how the Asian actors survive in a very predominantly white environment, which I felt very much so, because when I arrived in Hollywood, I learned that it was the white, the black, and then the Latino, and then the Asians in the very bottom. Not being a racist, but that is the fact, and that is still the fact today, because it's all political, population numbers, and all of that. But I learned how these Asian people survive, and I had to know myself how I'm going to survive in Hollywood, which I did quite well. But definitely meeting Kurt Russell and all these wonderful directors like John Carpenter, I got to understand how Hollywood work. And it was a great honor to be part of it. I never expect much of it. I just try to do my part and try to create all these actions as original as possible, because John would just say, okay, you're now in this room, you're going to shoot up, we're going to see you shooting up a lightning into the ceiling, and then we're going to have the whole ceiling is collapsing on you. So I said, I'm going to design it this way into four corners, and then you can draw in all the lightning after. And then when it's done, I saw it on the real screen, I said, oh, wow, that was quite amazing, Basically, I was blessed. I would say I was blessed to be part of that whole movie making process of Big Trouble.
And it's got to be it's just got to be so exciting to work with so much great talent. Obviously, you're bringing great talent to the table as well. So it's did you feel that you wanted to be a director at that point, or did you feel that it was later on in your career?
Back then, I can only think of one thing, is how to make myself not famous, but a significant actor. See, the way I do my thing is, whatever, in whichever area I do, whether it's a kung fu artist or just a dancer, or later on I got into acting, I'm a very focused person. So when I learn how to act, that's when I went to, also starting in New York, went to actor studio, you know, very famous actor studio, all these famous actors came from it. And then I went to LA, I went to another acting guy in Hollywood. Every week I'm studying. When I'm not on the set, I'm studying. So I think of myself, not as a Chinese actor, not as Bruce Lee, I think of myself as Marlon Brando. He was my image. I say, if I'm going to be an actor, I'm not going to be Bruce Lee, no. I'm not going to be Chinese Kung Fu guy, no. I want to be Marlon Brando. And that's the way I model myself after him. So I really study acting, and I hope that I can do something interesting in whichever part I take up, so that people will be looking at me as an actor and not as a Kung Fu actor. That's how I pursue my career as an actor.
Definitely, it's got to be, you know, I can tell why you and Daniel are friends, because I can tell that you guys have that same passion, that same fire for being the best version of yourselves that you can be, and the things that you do, that's very noticeable. And it's definitely something just to have that goal to be the, you know, you know, somebody like Marlon Brando that we know that was, you know, definitely a great actor. So it's definitely interesting to hear that. I wanted to bring up, Dan, do you think it's a good time to bring up the fan questions that we have? Or
yeah, I think it's a good time. I think, yeah, because again, as far as, hopefully I don't overstep, but for James and I, the fans are why we're here and we continue to work on this. You know, we can come up with new material, not only for our own creativeness, but really in the end, we have to, you know, we got to make the fans happy.
So we had a couple of questions. These are super fans of Big Trouble in Little China. Matt brings us the question, does James keep in touch with the rest of the Storms?
Yes, I do. I Peter Kwan especially, and definitely Lo Pan.
Okay.
Carter Wong, you know, Carter Wong is in Hong Kong, but he's missing right now because I'm actually organizing a couple of big events with Comic-Con in UK, Germany, and also in Australia. And everybody want to bring three of the Storms to the next big event, but I haven't been able to find Carter Wong. I believe he's still alive, but he's missing. His students said that he's deep in China. Nobody can get in touch with him. But I have been in touch with most of the guys, except Dennis Dunn. You know, he's been a long lost friend again. But everybody else, in terms of the Asian community, I'm in touch with everybody. And I'm actually organizing some events here in Europe. And I'd love to include Daniel in it. You know, I have to say something about Daniel. I have been a Kung Fu man, what, for 40 years. There's only a few people I respect in the business. You know, I mean, so many wonderful Hollywood action actors, including Kosuke, I can't remember his first name, you know, Japanese guy with a samurai sword. And also the earlier was someone I respected was Toshiro Mifune, because I've been in big black and white Japanese samurai movies. And in terms of Kung Fu, it's got to be Bruce Lee, ultimate. I got nobody else. But one other man that I discovered in America was Daniel. Let me tell you why. Let me tell you why. Daniel came to China when he was a youngster. I don't know what how old he was, but he came in 1985. My God, you think about 85. You know, 85. I'm in America. I think I finished my college already, you know, and I was already pursuing my acting career, kind of slowly blooming. And he's already in China. He told me he was in Wuhan learning wushu, you know. That was amazing. And then recently I went into his Instagram and I saw his incredible collection of these movements that he does. One thing special was his rope dart. Just so you know, I got my own team of Shaolin Kung Fu. They've been performing for Jackie Chan and Jet Li and all over Asian TV. They perform in Europe 100 tours already. And I got my own team. And I'm the director and the producer. So anything related to Wushu and Shaolin Kung Fu, I'm an expert. But to know a white man, not to be, you know, white Caucasian man came to China in 85 and learned how to do Chinese original traditional kung fu, especially with rope darts. That's amazing. You know why? Because my team, I don't have anybody that can do rope darts. Only the 12 section whip, you know, the steel whip, which one of my team members does it very well. But I haven't been able to find anybody that does rope dart. It's such an old art, and he does it so well, even at his age. That's what I have. Incredible respect for this man. And when I met him, I said to Daniel, I said, why is it that nobody put you on the big screens? Yeah. He's such an original guy that does all these incredible kicks. He can do kicks just like karate. You know, all the karate guy and the taekwondo guy, why nobody hired him when he was young and handsome? That's one thing that really bothered me, you know? Really? Everybody, I mean, all these.
What is going on? Yeah.
Yeah, Cannon did all that big movie with, you know, what I'm talking about, another white guy. I respect for him, but what about Daniel? Why does nobody give him a job? I said, if I had met him back in the early 90s, I would have introduced him to John Carpenter's and all the productions I did. Mm. Just so you know, I helped out at least 20. Asian actors in Hollywood that were struggling, that were unknown actors that became actor. Without me, they wouldn't be what they are today. And that is fact. And now, I don't want to take any credit, but that is fact. Because you know what? I'm a man who likes to see young people grow, even today. You know, young people with the potential, I like to help them. Mark DeCuskis is one. Another guy is the Japanese actor. Sorry, my memory failed me. Mark was just a stuntman in the Universal Studio, diving off the cliff and all that. Mm-hmm. And this Japanese guy, he was like a extra on the movie of Big Trouble. Mm. But I introduced Mark into a TV series I did called Nasty Boys, produced by Dick Wolf. You know, because Mark and I were training Kung Fu almost every week, he taught me how to do tumbling, you know, and then we do Kung Fu together. So we were very close, like brothers. So I said, Mark, you can't be just a stuntman all your life. You know, you need to do something with your career because you are such a handsome looking young man and you can do all these incredible arts. His father was a famous, you know, martial art instructor already. So one time my producer said, okay, you're gonna be riding your motorcycle and all that in this shot. And I said, you know what? I can ride a motorcycle, but for safety's sake, can I bring in my stuntman? I said, who do you want to suggest? I said, I got this incredible guy, look just like me. He said, go ahead, bring him up. That's how I gave him the first job. All he had to do is ride a motorcycle. He doesn't even have to do the kung fu. And I gave him the job. You know why? Because I really see the potential in him. My eyes really is right. My instinct was right. Mm. I gave him that little job so that he can get into the union and look at him today. Look at him today. Okay.
And I can see that. I again, that's another thing that I can see that a reason why you guys have been friends, because Daniel is also a person that loves to empower his students and loves to empower the people that he feels that has potential. And, you know, I've always appreciated his friendship and his advice and the interactions. I'm telling you, when he meets, he could meet the most strangest, stranger in a comic convention. And that person's already Daniel's friend. You are my friend. I can take care of you, blah, 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 blah. And so it's very noticeable between the two of you. So that's definitely, I appreciate that a lot. The second question that I have here from the fans, this one comes from Fran. Was there talk about having a standalone movie about the Three Storms?
Oh, that is a good one, Fran. That is a great idea. I definitely wanted to talk to, that was by 20th Century Fox. I think Disney owns it now. Mm-hmm. I have been asked by many of my fans about, is there going to be a remake of Big Trouble? You know, Rock claimed that he wanted to star in it and do a remake. I think
that was in 2017. I think it was back then when it was, but there hasn't been anything new in the air. Yeah.
But you know why? Script has to do with everything. You know, to prepare a script that would be as good as the original one, I think, you know, it's gonna take somebody or some producer that have the eye and the intelligence to make it happen. You know, one thing I respect about Big Trouble in Little China, the created by John, that's different from a lot of action movies today, is that it is fun action. There's no violence. You don't see anybody head get chopped off, arm get chopped off. It's all just fun action. It's almost like a cartoon, but it's an adult cartoon kind of a thing. And that's what's so incredible. And that's why I have respect for John, okay? But that's a perspective I like to put in. But go back to Fran's question. Yes, I would like to go back. I'm going back in September with Daniel taking me to the convention. Okay. I'm gonna talk to Disney myself and find out who is in charge of the creative. I said, you wanna redo the Big Trouble in Little China, you have James back behind. You know why? I'm a producer, I'm a writer, besides being an actor. I got another 20 million fans out there that wanna watch Big Trouble in Little China, plus Mortal Kombat, another 100 million people that wanna see the remake of Big Trouble in Little China, because these two projects already jailed together. The fans are jailed together.
Absolutely. So,
but you know, and going back and listening to what James has to say, that is really true, because you have famous movies that, like Jet Li was in, Once Upon a Time in China. And you look at the martial arts fight, there's not really that much blood in there when you're watching it. But everybody is like, oh my God, the choreography and the fight action is so good that guess what? They don't need to have that much amount of blood in it, because the action is not only filling their creative side, but also kind of their they get lost in the art of wushu or kung fu.
Yes.
You know, just by the pure movement and the beauty of it, even though it's deadly, they're like, oh my God, it looks beautiful. So elegant.
Yes. It's like a dance. And it becomes like a dance.
Absolutely.
Like ballet. Yeah,
and going back to your comment about how the movie feels like a comic book, it's something that I think that was the part that me as a kid made me fall in love with the movie, was the fact that it was, I always tell people that the best way to describe Big Trouble in Little China is expect the unexpected, because the movie starts with a girl getting kidnapped in the airport. Then all of a sudden they run with this truck in an alley. Then a turf war breaks out, and then these three dudes come out of nowhere. And then the truck runs over a dude that for some reason survives and blinds the other guy. There's a floating head. There's an orangutan type monster. You don't know what's going to happen next. And it makes you, it has that comic book feel, or that comic book style story or sci-fi story that made it so, it just, you know, you wanted to watch more, like what's next. So you were definitely part of that journey. Another question that I have here, and thank you for answering these questions, James. Okay, this one's an interesting one. Why was lightning the only storm that did not have lines? Why was he silent?
Why, John? Maybe you can answer this question.
And I have a follow-up question to that, because I noticed one thing in the movie. Yeah. So Rain has a suit and tie. Thunder has a suit and tie, but Lightning doesn't have a suit and tie. You're always in your Lightning costume. And right. He's always Lightning. Yeah, that's true. I found that so interesting, because it was like the other two have a double persona, like a hidden identity, but you were always Lightning.
Well, I guess that was intended by John, and I never really raised that question back then because I was too busy trying to figure out what I'm going to do with my character Lightning. I'm glad that everybody remembered me on that character. But let me go back to the earlier interview that we talked about. Now, what was the question again? Just remind me, because my head
is spinning. Why was Lightning the only storm that did not have lines?
Okay, good. Talking about the audition again. Like I said, I'm a very ambitious man. I never take two. I only want to take the first one. So when I auditioned, I read for Dennis Dunn's part. And I worked on it. And then when I didn't get it, I was kind of disappointed. I got to tell you, I'm very disappointed, because I know my acting ability. I believe in my acting ability. I don't know Dennis Dunn, but when I went on the set, I said to myself, yes, I know why I didn't get a part. You know why? I'm too tall. Hmm. If I'm going to play Jack Burton's sidekick, I got to be a smaller guy. And that's why I wasn't picked. That's probably one of the reasons.
Wow. Okay.
Okay. Although I do respect Dennis Dunn's acting, he definitely was right for the part. You know, he was very cute. I think John picked him for a good reason. Because I will look too menacing to play next to Jack Burton.
Absolutely.
Because I'm very big, you know, I'm very strong looking. But Jack Burton is, after all, the number one lead. So the sidekick has to be more cute, that kind of character. So Dennis definitely had a part for it. And I also, in my heart, I was saying to myself, why is it that Lightning had any speech, any lines?
It's definitely very interesting. That question came from Joe.
But two, may I add, the other guys can wear a suit. I mean, if James puts on a suit, Lightning is going to be shooting all over the place.
Yeah, it would kind of tear away. Yeah.
A storm that cannot be disguised. You right. cannot be like, oh, just because you put on a suit, you're always shooting, you know, in all your scenes, you are in control of lightning, right. You know, of electricity. So everything you do is like that. Right. So when I watched the movie, I was like, oh, he's quiet and he doesn't say anything, because Lightning is one of the deities that cannot fit in with mankind.
That's right.
Because he's a god. Yeah, the other guys can fit in because they kind of look, if they're quiet and act kind of little normal, they could pass off for somebody walking down the street. But James cannot just walk down the street, because Lightning will be like shooting out all right. over the place, and you can't disguise that. So yeah, when I saw the movie, I really, for real, I thought, well, he doesn't open his mouth, because if he probably opened his mouth, there's a chance that something would shoot out. At least back in the day,
That's a great way to, definitely, yeah.
A fan of the movie, I always thought that. Sure, he doesn't talk or anything like that. When I read the question, I was like, naturally, he doesn't talk. You know what? You cannot disguise that. If you put him in a suit, Lightning's still going to be shooting out. But so that is my two cents on it.
And it makes the character more interesting, too. Because if you think about it, this character is a little mysterious. Like, I want to know more about, yeah. you know, about the character and what's up with him. Like, what? Yeah. So, you know, yeah. so.
Third, That's why in the second movie, he needs to be the lead character.
Or yes. Play the father or somebody, you know, whatever, since I'm a little older now. I think it would be interesting if Disney would say, yes, brought me in as a producer, I would definitely do rise to the Three Storms and make them a bigger character. But of course, Rock has got to be the lead, and how they are going to really clash and really having these big fight between the Rock and the Three Storms. I think that would be interesting, you know, with
Uzis and guns.
Yeah, he's shooting his Uzi and gun and saying, what happened? No bullets stuck on their body. That would be an interesting line to say, you know, and then you see all the three guys were like climbing on the walls like a gecko.
You know what? I have some popcorn on the microwave right now. I'm ready for this film.
Yeah, where do I give my money for that?
I want to get that ticket quick.
Yeah, I'm sure every fan is like, okay, that idea right now. Okay, where's the money?
Take my money.
I already know, because I kept telling my fans when I do my interview these days, I said, if Big Trouble comes out today, or even 2 years ago before the COVID, it's gonna be over 100 million domestic, and then another 200 million around the world for sure. It just came out a little too early, and that 20th Century Fox didn't put in much of the advertising dollar to push it, because you know why? They spend, 20 million on the production, and yet they were afraid to spend more money on the advertising, which is what I understand, because they were afraid that on that same week they have a Ghostbuster coming out, and they say, oh wow, Ghostbuster with all that, you know, incredible Hollywood actors, and then this one we only have Jack Burton, you know, Kurt Russell in it, and then unknown Asian actors. It's not gonna be this, so let's not even spend a dime on it. That's the mistake that 20th Century Fox made.
Yeah.
But if it was come out today, I can tell you, a guarantee 100 million or even 200 million domestically in America, for sure. So therefore, Disney, they need to do a remake on Big Trouble.
Hey.
Quickly, next year.
This man
with James
Pax
and Daniel together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And I will moderate the Q&A. Another question that I have from Prince Mora, was the hat, armor, and any other part of the costume difficult to wear?
Oh, everything was easy. It's definitely the hat. And let me tell you how the hat came about. Because original hat, you know, of these samurais or the Chinese swordsmen, it's usually just simple straw hats, you know, quite just to hide underneath the hot sun. It's usually very light and it's just around the head. But what John did was, again, he did a lot of research, and he's definitely a samurai movie fan, because that hat came out of another black and white movie in a Japanese movie, which I saw. Mm. It's exactly the same hat with these little windows in front. And that's how big it was. And he copied it from the samurai movie. And when I first time put it on, I said, my God, that wasn't supposed to be the swordsman's head, because it's so huge. It was like four times bigger than the original straw hat. The original straw hat is probably like a paperweight. Hmm. But this head was 15 pounds. It's literally 15 pounds, because it was done, again, handmade with every little straws. And when I wore it, I really feel sore, you know? And we were on the set 10 hours a day. When I'm not on in front of the screen, I said, please take off my hat. I can hardly move my hat. And so that hat worth a lot of money. And it's, again, definitely makes the Three Storms original persona.
Absolutely.
It really make it work.
What about the weapons? You had the twirling. What is those? Are those real martial arts weapons? Pardon my ignorance.
Yeah. Actually, Herme has the mountain has those type of daggers. It's like an action traditional weapon.
The way they did it, yes. Chinese weapon, it comes in 360 different forms. But go back to the original one they made, because many fans ask me how they got it twirling like a propeller. Mm-hmm. Well, again, there was propeller in the front, and then in the back, they have a little motor here, so you don't see it. So whenever we are ready to shoot, they have to click it, and then the motor will go, and then the thing
spin around.
Turn. So it was, everything was custom made. It was originally was so innovative. Even when I wore it, I said, my God, how did you come up with an idea like that? You know, and it looks so original and interesting, like a toy.
Absolutely. Definitely. I have a question here for Dan. What did you, when you watched, what was your impression the first time that you watched Big Trouble in Little China?
Oh my God. It was just an awesome. Yeah. Like I said, it was really cool because at the time everybody's doing regular, you know, a lot of ninjas from Japan, a lot of karate guys, a lot of things that were like mainstream, but Big Trouble in Little China really had, was really, like I said, I was heavily into Chinese martial arts, and I was just like, oh my God, everything they're doing in there is something that can relate to Chinese martial arts and to China. Even it was cool to know that, sure, as you mentioned, you know, Kurt Russell is the main star, but not really, because he is the main character, but the stars are really, there were so many stars.
Right.
You know, Lo Pan had it, as the character Lo Pan, he had it, his share of that. Egg Chen had his share. The Three Storms were mysterious and had their share. Everybody, like there were so many main characters who could go as the main character, I think kept that interaction really good, because that way no one person was carrying the whole movie.
Absolutely. You know,
the whole group was carrying the whole movie. So when I saw it, I was like, man, this is so, so deep into mysticism and what the Chinese culture is always associated with, you know, because they're always like trying to, they hide, you know, when you practice martial arts, you try to hide your martial arts so that way you're not defeated, you know? And so all these legends and stuff and all this stuff is, it was impacted into one hour and a half movie. It was like so inspiring. As I said, it was really inspiring.
And it's interesting. One thing that you mentioned, because I watched the movie, and I know that if you watch the movie now, it feels like Kurt Russell is actually the sidekick. Yeah. Like he's not really the. You know what I mean? Like it's because everybody is like definitely taking over the battles, and everybody's like kicking butt, and Kurt Russell is, you know, he's the hero of the movie, but at the same time he's stumbling here, he gets hit in the head and whatnot. So I don't know, it's interesting. The last question that I have here is from Brent, and this is, I second this question: when we will see James Pax in a convention in the United States?
Well, let me go back to the previous question and then come back to this one.
You were
talking about, because I'm more of a producer and a writer now, because I really emphasize on analyzing these characters. Now, in terms of Jack Burton, I even went back and read the script. He is not the typical hero like Rock. He's always breaking everybody's bones, you know, jumping from building to buildings. He's like a quirky character that stumbles onto this road of trying to pick up a Chinese lady from Beijing and then stumble into this whole mystical world. Mm-hmm. So therefore, he's not a stereotypical action character. He's just a quirky character that kind of, you know, fell into this trip, into this mystical trip. And that's what makes it interesting, because I don't think every hero needs to beat everybody up.
Absolutely.
He's just a quirky character. And then John was so cleverly, or I should say the screenwriter was so cleverly to identify him as that kind of character. And yet he is the storyteller that takes us through this journey. And then every other characters comes out along the way. And yet when you look at it, you say, wow, that could be another movie. That could be another movie. But that's the ingenious of John Carpenter and also the screenwriter. So I have to give credit to them. for doing that, really. You know, that was ingenious, because you look at the movie today, mm-hmm. few character like that, you know, bad men or whatever, they are the one beating everybody up. And that's what we want people to see. Hero character, no. Mm-hmm. But John create a different kind of hero that you can relate to. He's just a weak guy. Anybody can beat him up. But right. He's a hero in the end.
Right. And it's, he's and just living in. Okay. And especially in the 80s, where you have so many action heroes that are, you know, they have that stereotypical, you know, I'm here to save the world and I have all the weapons in the world. So it was definitely something different.
Yeah, but I think James really hit on it. Jack Burton, the Kurt Russell character, is the storyteller, and he's not really the hero. Like you said, he is the storyteller, which is brilliant, because that way everyone shines in it. And that's one of the magic, I think, behind Big Trouble in Little China, is when, you know, whether it's when James takes the, when you see James coming down out of the sky and stealing the whole scene, or when you see Lopan getting run over and standing back up, that steals the whole scene. Mm-hmm. There are so many opportunities for actors to shine. So it was really, I think that it really is, as James said, he's a storyteller. So absolutely. It lets everybody really shine about it. Even, you know, even one of the guys who didn't have a major part, who came in later, who was the newspaper guy, he was mm-hmm. funny, but his role was very, you can be relatable. All these people were relatable. They're normal people, so you think, until you realize that everyone has a little bit of magic behind them.
That's right. Yes. That's what's so amazing about this movie, Big Trouble. Yeah. Now, go back to the convention. Yes. Since I've been spending more time in China doing research, you know, on Shaolin and all of that, and study of my original heritage, which is Chinese language and Chinese culture, I have written up 4 script, which I'm going to tell a little later. But definitely I am depending on Daniel to, and you, Louis, of course, to take me around back to Hollywood. To do some convention. The last time I was there, almost like five, six years ago, I did one in Indianapolis, and then I did one in Burbank. Yes, Burbank, mm-hmm. which was very successful. I think over 1,000 people came and got my autograph. And I was very pleased, you know, to see all these wonderful fans coming around. They still remember Lightning. They don't have to remember James Pax, but as long as they remember Lightning, my heart goes out for them. And I just about 2 months ago, I joined in this big community of Big Trouble website, and just realized there's another 40,000 fans out there. And when I joined, everybody welcomed me. I said, you know what? I'm not a movie star. They always say, oh, Mr. Pax, sir, you know, you are a legend. I said, no, I'm not a legend. Lightning is a legend. I'm just an actor. I'm just a regular dude like you. You are doing your own work as a graphic designer or, you know, construction worker. I'm just another guy. I'm doing my acting and I'm doing my writing and all of that. So I say, I'm not a star. You don't need to call me a star. I'm just James. But I'm glad I'm part of this wonderful project, which is Big Trouble and the Lightning. And so therefore, it would be a great honor to work with Daniel, and that, you know, we can go to these conventions, whether it's in America or in South America, and maybe I will include him also in my, you know, trip here in the UK and Australia.
Absolutely.
Be good to meet up with the Mortal Kombat and the Big Trouble fan group together. They should all join together to let the studio know how much of the fan power that we have, so that they have to listen to us. Not just listen to your studio writers telling you what to do. No, you need to listen to the fans. See what the fans want. They want, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Asian subject matter.
I wanted to, Dan, I'm sorry, Dan, go ahead.
No, yeah. But, you know, again, Luis, thanks for this platform and this interview to let people know about the availability to have James Pax, actor, producer, writer, Lightning at events, because in reality, people watching this, if you're watching this right now as fans of Mortal Kombat, Big Trouble in Little China, which are really, you know, there was Big Trouble in Little China and we melted Mortal Kombat into it and it inspired this creation. But really, when you have us at event, it is the same genre. It is the same period. And if you're listening to this interview and you got an event near you and you want us to come out, get a hold of Luis, you get a hold of James, all of our information will be on here. Reach out to us. Give us a lead. Give us what event is by you. We'll reach out to them and do all the negotiating and all the work so that way we can get to know you personally, get out to an area by you and, you know, have this joyous moment, you know, or to understand that we are just people like you and we want to hang out with you.
Absolutely. And James, I know that with all due respect, I know that you said that, you know, the real legend is Lightning and that you're just an actor. I think, in my opinion, that you you created that character. You gave life to that character. And I think that the reason you were selected for that role is because they knew that you would bring greatness to that character. So I think that you definitely receive a lot of credit to that. Because the portrayal of Lightning was one that me as a fan, thank you for that. My last question before we finish this great interview, and thank you all for participating. What would James now, director, producer, actor, would tell young James Pax during the production of Big Trouble in Little China as advice? If he had the chance to see them now, back in time, what advice would you give yourself?
Well, I should say, you know, I know that Big Trouble, I've been told by many fans that it has been with them for over 20, 30 years. They are inspired by it, and it kind of accompany them like a friend, you know, throughout their childhood. And I was very moved by that. One thing I'd like to mention is that 20, 30 years ago, I also created a show called Not Only What's Happening, which I became the first Asian American producer that produced an infomercial show, just like Entertainment Tonight. I had an Asian version.
And the red carpet, right? Chinese theater, yes, I think it was, right?
Yes. This is like, I was, again, groundbreaking. I was the first Asian American director, producer, and host to do a show, which is like Entertainment Tonight. Entertainment Tonight had 50 people on their team. We only had 4 people. Hmm. And I was an instigator, I was a producer, director, and the host, the male host. We have a lady and a male. And I instigated that show, and it was sold all over Asia. And but the point I want to make is, I interview a lot of Hollywood stars. You know, you name it, I interview them all, and I met them in person. One of the person I wanted to mention, because he's going to relate to what I'm going to say, is Morgan Freeman, because he gave me a lot of inspiration. Mm. Morgan Freeman gave me a 2-hour interview at the Four Seasons Hotel. And at the end, I also asked him, you know, what kind of advice can you give to movie-inspired, whether they're actors or producers or just a cameraman or whatever? He said to me that if you believe in something, if you believe in yourself, you never give up. Because the minute you give up is the minute you're going to fail. If you don't give up, you haven't failed because you're still on the way to making it happen. He said, James, look at me now. Look at me now. I'm Morgan Freeman. I'm in front of you and you're interviewing me because I didn't give up my dream. He said, 10, 15 years ago, I was a nobody. He said, I was an English teacher on some cable channel. I said, oh, that was you. I remember. He said, yes, that was me. And I had that contract for 8 years. And I thought I was going to be on that show for another 20 years, but no. You know, somebody offered me to do this play called Driving Miss Daisy. It was in New York. And then after that play won the Obie Award, then they were offered like a $2 million budget to do the movie Driving Miss Daisy. And he said, that was groundbreaking. That's why I'm sitting here, you're interviewing me, because I never gave up my dream. So I like to transcend the spirit to my fans. Don't give up. Daniel and I are all both over 50 years old. We never gave up our dream. Daniel will be on the big screen. I guarantee you that, because he's going to be in my movie. But on top of that, I'm over 50 years old. Probably many people forgot who James Pack was, but at least they remember Lightning. That's good enough. But have I given up? No. I'm going to go back to Hollywood. I'm going to tell you that you should listen to me now, not tell me what to do. I will tell you what's going to make $100 million domestically and $200 million around the world with Shaolin Warriors 7. That's going to be my next movie. I will direct, I will produce, and I already wrote it. Again, that movie, I would say it's kind of in between, or a gel of Matrix and Ninja Turtle.
Okay.
See, that's pretty far apart. Right? Matrix and Ninja Turtle. You know why? Because after all, it is Chinese Wushu, Shaolin Kung Fu. From the title, you know there's going to be Shaolin Kung Fu back out. Remember Jet Li made famous Shaolin Temple, that movie? That's what, 30, 40 years ago. That's what made Jet Li become famous. So I'm bringing that back, that genre. The original 80s Hong Kong film, it's not about violence. It's about action, choreographed action like a dance. Plus, the basis, the background, the story, it is that these Shaolin Kung Fu warriors are going to travel through time, so they're going to get on a time machine. Mm. They're going to go into the future. They're going to go into the past, and they are going to be the savior of the world. I call them the world, the Earth Defenders. They're going to defend just like all the comic book heroes, but they're going to be Shaolin Temple warriors. They're going to travel through time into the future to save the world. Not through violence, excuse me, through Kung Fu. Means you can shoot a Uzi, you can shoot a, you know, fire a rocket at them. You're not going to hit them, but they are going to take care of you with their traditional Kung Fu and their Chinese, all 360 different kind of weapons. They will take care of you. Bad guys, watch out.
I hope that I can be considered for the red carpet for that, because I want to be first row to watch that movie. That sounds amazing. James, thank you so much for your time. Dan, as always, thank you for the opportunity. This has been a great interview. I appreciate your time, James. Thank you for your work. This is coming from one of the many fans of Big Trouble in Little China, and I hope that one of these days we can connect in person and chat and discuss with Dan, and hopefully we'll get some conventions rolling too, and we can have you connect with some of the great fans of Big Trouble in Little China. Anything that you guys, Dan, anything that you want to add?
I think for me, James should give his social media.
Absolutely.
Social media contacts, because we got to get this ball rolling.
Absolutely. James, can you share your social media? How can people find you?
James Pack's Instagram. Is it James Pack's Instagram? I'm definitely on the Facebook. You just look up James Pack, you will see me. But definitely also on the Instagram as well. Okay, so these two, you can definitely find me. But just so you know, I mean, because of the requests of my fans, I have started my own website, you know.
Awesome.
Memorabilia website, which is going to be called Hot Lips Mall, MALL.NET, which you will see a lot of my autograph photos, and also we're creating original posters, a remake of the Big Trouble in Little China poster, and also action figures and many things related to lightning. Okay, and my Instagram, what is an Instagram name? What does it say? My eyes no good.
I think it is James
Pax. Let's,
I think so.
Yeah. Let's first one.
And it's just okay, James Pax with a space in between. Simple as that. So you definitely can find me. And, all right.
And can you repeat the website once more? That's where they can find like merchandise and everything.
Hot Lips. H O T L I P S Mall mall.net.
Perfect.
Which is brand new, will be up by next Monday, and you can browse the many interesting things, because in China we get everything made here, custom made. All right. But go back again about interracial integration. I mean, from your name and Daniel's name, you are Latin heritage. Am I right to say that?
That is correct. Puerto Rican.
Puerto Rican. Okay. Let me tell you about my childhood. Okay. Because when I was a kid growing up in America, my parents were in Hong Kong. They had no time for me. They were busy doing business in Hong Kong. And I was left there with a nice apartment. I was alone, and I went to a high school in Hightstown, New Jersey. But there was a wonderful Puerto Rican family called the Torres family. The husband and wife took care of me, just like my parents. So I can tell you, I am very much Latin related because they were my godparents.
There you go.
And Mrs. Torres. Okay. And that's why I believe in racial integration. That's what I believe in. So that is real background about my childhood.
That is awesome. Did they give you rice and beans? Because that's
definitely. Oh, every weekend.
You're officially Puerto Rican. Let me tell you that.
Definitely.
Officially.
I know everything about Puerto Rican and Latino culture.
Yes.
Also, one other thing, just a little thing to end.
Yes.
Almost 35 or 40 years ago, when I was just a teenager, I was not even an actor. I was just a college graduate. I was invited by a friend, again, Torres family friend, Paredes family in Chile, for a little vacation. So I stayed in Santiago for 3 months. And I was a singer back then. You know, I was not even an actor. And I had my guitar with me, and every morning I was singing, you know, and then next to my friend's house, on the second floor, the window opens up, a beautiful Chilean girl appears. Her name is Lorna. I still remember Lorna. And because of her beauty, she doesn't understand me because she doesn't speak well of English. I don't speak very well Latino. But we were looking at each other, kind of fell in love, and I wrote a song called Lorna, Lorna, I Love You. Can you imagine? That's how romantic I was when I was a kid. And then later I found out that she was actually staying with a guy. I was so disappointed. I was heartbroken. But you know what? The amazing thing on my 3 months vacation is I became a popular singer in Chile. I became the first American, Chinese, Asian singer that appeared on Chilean TV. I did 3 big shows on TV. The first show was amazing. It's called Mr. Chile. So they are not doing Miss Chile, but they are having this contest for male model. So all like 40 male models on stage, 5,000 lady audience, and I was one of the entertainers. So when I came on stage, they said, we have this American, you know, Asian singer from New York, James Pax. And then I came out and nobody said anything. It was very quiet. I was a little nervous. I said, what the heck? So I just strummed my guitar and my 20-piece band behind me. We had a 2-day rehearsal. And all you hear for 2 songs was the applause and the screaming of the ladies. I did not even hear what I was singing, but I was totally in a dream. What's so important about this journey was it made me realize that there's something about you, James, that people want you on the screen. People want you as a public figure. Because I was just a college student. I was performing in college, you know, little concerts here and there. But then that was the experience that really opened me up. I said, and said to myself, you could be an artist, whether as a singer or maybe an actor. Because back then I was not planning to be an actor because I need to take over my parents' business. And that's my important journey. And that's my relationship again with Latino culture.
That is awesome. I am so happy that we have another Latino brother in the house. But again, thank you so much for this amazing interview, James. Thank you, Daniel, for helping us putting this together. I am really happy that you guys were able to reconnect after so many years. And I'm really, really looking forward to see what the future brings, especially for the fans of Lightning and the fans of James Pax. So
thank you, Luis, and thank you, Daniel.
Leave a comment in the down below, wherever you hear this. We want questions, because hopefully I can talk James into doing a live interview where some of the fans reach out live to us. Maybe we'll either do it on Instagram or Facebook, where you know, you have a question, and thank you for sending in your questions. Mm-hmm. But there's nothing like getting it a little live James Pax in your life.
Yeah, that would be interesting. For sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Dan, do you want to share your social media just in case?
Yeah, actually, everybody knows my social media. Facebook, Master Thief, I've seen it, Instagram. And today was really my thing to reconnect with James to the public. You know, at this point in our lives, to know that we, you know, we're still going, but you know, we have a bright future ahead. So
absolutely.
Never give up, please. Never give up. Whatever you wanted to do, there's always a chance. If you don't give up, you still have the chance. Even 1%, you gotta make it happen. Believe in yourself. That's what I want to tell everybody, because I believe in myself, and Daniel does the same. And we need to have a belief in ourselves. Mm-hmm. In ourself to make your dream happen, and it will happen if you just keep on doing it. It will happen before you lay down in the grave.
Absolutely.
And two, Luis, if they're too shy to contact James, what is an email that they can contact you at to get a hold of James?
They can email me at spmtalent@gmail.com. That's SPM, S as in Sam, P as in Peter, M as in Master. See what I did there? talent@gmail.com. That is my email. So feel free to send any requests through that email, and we'll definitely work with you to put something together and bring these two superstars to your show. So with that, one last thank you to both of you for being in this interview, and I would like to close with my usual closing. Remember, everybody, greatness starts from small beginnings. Thank you, everyone.